Episode 1538, My Strength is My Story with Matt Fitzgerald. Life is a marathon.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a stop
sign, watching people drive. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have with us an ultra marathoner. Oh, yes, Matt Fitzgerald is in the house. He wrote a book, Life is a Marathon. We're going to run the whole gamut. You're going to want to stay tuned. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Matt's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Well, I try to think about what words would describe my chat with Matt. And there's nothing to describe it. His book is so mesmerizing. It will suck you in. You will feel every emotion that there is. And I'm telling you right now, you have to read the book because our interview is going to be great, but it doesn't serve its justice. And with Matt and Nataki's life and what they have been through, it's not just about running. It's about the inner journey and what Matt discovered through it with his marriage. It's all about a memoir of love and endurance. I promise you, you will be blessed. Stay tuned for the entire story with Matt Fitzgerald. Life is a marathon. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have an incredible runner in the midst of us. Oh yes, he's an ultra marathoner, Matt Fitzgerald. He is a husband of 18 years this year to Nataki, but really Queenie, their puppy, rules a house, especially with her 5 a.m. wake-up licks. Matt is an endurance sports writer and certified sports nutritionist. He is a coach and spokesperson for PEAR Sports and former senior editor at Triathlete and Competitor. Matt has also contributed to Men's Health, Outside, Runner's World, Shape, and many other publications. But what puts me in awe is that he's the author of more than 20 books. Did you hear me? 20 books, including his newest book, Life is a Marathon, a memoir of love and endurance. Well, Matt, I got my running shoes on and I'm ready for a few miles. How are you? Welcome, my friend.
I'm doing well. It's great to be with you.
Well, I'm thrilled to have you here, and I just have got to say from the get-go, when I looked at this book, you know, you look at the book and you see the cover, you can judge a book by its cover. When I began my marathon walk to read your book, I was more entranced, beyond intrigued, and I was dumbfounded at times as to your story that lies within these pages.
Yeah. I mean, it's, I might be biased. It's my life, but, you know, I've had a pretty intense, adulthood. You know, I had a pretty charmed, childhood, but, yeah, I mean, it's been a really interesting journey with, you know, highs and lows, good and bad. And of course, having read the book, you're aware of that. You know, I didn't write this book, say, 10 years ago because I didn't have my happy ending yet. So, you know, I'm happy to say that I and Nataki and Queenie are in a good place now. So, yeah, despite the lows and some of the intense moments we've experienced, you know, we do sort of have a happy ending to the story.
Well, let's start out first with what brings you joy?
Yeah, boy. I mean, I love life, you know, and so I have some great passions. But really, you know, they could have ended up being something else. I started running early through my father's influence. So that's been a lifelong passion. You know, maybe if my dad had been a tennis player, I would be equally passionate about tennis. But, you know, that wasn't my experience. So, you know, I started at 11. I'm 47 now. So, I still love it. I'm competitive, but that's not the only reason I do it. I do it for the adventure, for the inner journey it takes me on. I love writing. That's another great passion. Interestingly, I got the writing from my father as well, who, as a novelist. So I'm a chip off the old block in a few days. But I also just love to play, and I love relationships. You know, I was always going to be the kind of guy who ended up being a nester, who tried to find a soulmate. Luckily, I did. And just to go on that that incredible journey. You know, so many people think of marriage, or maybe some of the guys I know think of marriage as like sacrificing freedom, you know, something you give up in exchange for maybe something else. But I view it as freedom. You know, you just, when you go that deep with someone who, you know, obviously it has to be someone who's compatible, someone you can grow with. But that's just an amazing journey and such a stimulus for growth. That, you know, that's obviously a huge part of my life, as well. Just, you know, my relationship with, Nataki, is probably number one, I would say.
Oh, well, I've had the privilege of seeing a few pictures of the two of you, and I just got to say, she is absolutely stunning, and you make a beautiful couple, and your story is even more stunning. And so before we jump into kind of where we go through the highs and lows and through the mountains and the roundabouts, I feel like we're going to run a marathon today together. Let's start back when you first fell in love with running. And you found it through your father, but it also led you to high school, and something somewhat tragic happened when you made a decision that changed the course of your life.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, my dad was sort of a casual runner in a sense. He ran marathons, and this is back in the mid-80s when not everyone was doing it. So, you know, it seemed sort of hardcore at the time, but he wasn't trying to win. You know, he wasn't the fastest guy. He didn't care about being the fastest guy, you know. But when I got into it, it turned out I was bad at every other sport. You know, anything with a ball, I was just uncoordinated. You know, I was like Bambi on stilts. But with running, I actually was pretty good at it. And every kid's a sucker for something they have a gift for. And so, you know, I performed well for my high school team. We won state championships, and it was great. But then, you know, running is, you know, runners like to say, my sport is your sport's punishment. It's hard. It, you know, because there is no ball. it's not really a playful sport. It's pretty painful, you know, racing as fast as you can. And some runners deal with that well, and others not so well. And I dealt with it not so well, especially when I rose to the level where I was one of the better runners in my state. And in order to achieve the next level, I had to sort of hurt even more, suffer even more in competition. I had to be willing to do that. And it turned out I just wasn't. And so, you know, the book starts with this moment where I sort of bottomed out, and I actually failed to show up to the start line of an important, very important race. A track race. And, you know, it was a moment where I sort of saw a side of myself I didn't want to see. You know, I thought I was a coward. You know, there's, simply put, I viewed myself as kind of a deserter. You know, it wasn't that serious. It's just a sport. But, you know, it was the most serious thing I had experienced. And it, like I said, in an otherwise charmed childhood, it was sort of a devastating moment. I ended up quitting running and didn't get back into it for years. So I just sort of, I decided, you know, I had sort of lost that battle to prove some mental toughness, to prove some grit. And I just carried that with me for a long time, but I sort of, you know, I buried it until getting back into running, you know, sort of, opened old wounds, you could say.
In this whole decision that you decided, and people are going to have to pick up a copy of their own book because we're not going to go into all the details, but I'm telling you, you lay all the details out, and it is better than any fiction book. And to think that it's real life. And I'm saying that with the utmost respect, because I look at it, when I read the memoir, I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is actually happening. You know, I felt like when you were kind of hiding and you weren't showing up at the starting line to run your race that would traject you into an area of incredibleness when it came to college and beyond, I was like, why didn't you do it? You know, yeah. I can only imagine now the generations that are up and coming that everything has been handed to them.
Yeah.
You know, and all with this stuff new in the news about the college scandal and all of this. And I'm sitting there reading your book going, and you threw it away by choice.
Yeah.
How did that guilt or cowardice haunt you until you made that decision to flip a switch?
Yeah, you know, I thought I had solved the problem by quitting. You know, I viewed the problem mainly as I'm afraid of the pain of racing. And so when I stopped racing, I felt like, okay, you know, I don't feel good about, you know, this failure, but I can just put it behind me. But, you know, in the book, I say, unfortunately, a coward on the race course is a coward off it as well. So I found that same mental weakness that sort of ruined running for me, I carried it with me in even after I quit running, because it would still affect, you're still the same person, you know, whether you're, you know, you have a number on your belly or the number is taken off, you're the same person. And, you know, if you lack mental toughness, it affects your relationships, it affects you in school, at work, anything you want to do. And that's what I ended up discovering is I couldn't outrun, you know, that self-knowledge. And, you know, to my credit, I will say, you know, some people are okay being cowards, you know, they just refuse to admit it. At least I admitted it to myself, and I it didn't sit well with me. And it was something that I was probably going to want to work on actively when I was ready, but I wasn't ready for a while.
Well, a while passed, and then you came across this setup with this incredible, beautiful girl. Tell us a little story about how you two first met, Nataki.
It was, in fact, a blind date. So I grew up in New Hampshire. I went to college in the Philadelphia area, and then I moved to California, to San Francisco specifically, to pursue a writing career. That's what I wanted to do. I was not athletic at the time. I lifted weights and did, you know, the whole gym thing, but, you know, running was behind me. And Nataki grew up in Oakland. She was born and raised in Oakland. And just through a mutual connection, actually a woman that neither of us knew terribly well, but something, she just saw some kind of possibility between us and set us up on a blind date at Jack London Square in Oakland. And, you know, talk about opposites attract. I mean, this is funny. This is 1997. So right around the time internet dating is first getting off the ground, you know. But that, you know, that's not how we met. It was kind of more the old-fashioned way. But if you just looked at us demographically on paper, there was nothing in common. You know, she's African-American. I'm white. I'm an East Coaster. So a rural guy. She's a city girl from the West Coast. She grew up, you know, in church. I did not. You know, so up and down the line, it was like, how's this going to work? But, you know, I, you know, speaking for myself, she would have to speak about whatever she saw in me. But I loved her personality. I just saw this incredible authenticity about her. And that's what I was fairly young. I was 26. I didn't maybe know exactly what I was looking for, but I definitely responded to that. I ended up discovering that she sort of had what I lacked. You know, she was fearless. You have to be fearless to be authentic, because you're not trying to hide behind a shell. You're just like, here I am, world, take me or leave me. So I think I was a little bit attracted to that. I thought, you know, if I sort of hang around this girl, I could become more like her. You know, I mean, not, you know, in certain ways, it could be like she could give be sort of an image for my path to becoming a better, stronger person. So I didn't realize any of this at the time. I just knew, I thought she was super cool, but it was something about her hooked me right away.
I think it's just adorable. I love hearing those hooks and, you know, those first attractions. And you guys had some interesting encounters on some of your dates. We're not going to go into the details of those, because I'm telling you right now, y'all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Life is a Marathon, a Memoir of Love and Endurance. And boy, is it a memoir of love. A few years passed, you got married. Where was running at this point in your life?
Yeah, when I first started dating Nataki, I was, as I mentioned, a casual exerciser. But it turned out that, you know, the writing job that I ended up getting in San Francisco was with a triathlon magazine. You know, part of the reason I got it was, you know, because I had a past interest in endurance sports. But at the time, I really had no interest. But just being in that environment, it sort of reawakened, it relit the spark, you could say. And I ended up just on a lark jumping into a triathlon completely unprepared on the island of St. Martin. And I actually, Nataki was along with me for that trip. It was before we got married, about 15 months into our relationship. And I suffered a terrible humiliation. Not only was I unprepared, I hadn't trained, but I was hungover when I started the race. It was just, you know, one of those rum-soaked Caribbean junkets. But something about that particular humiliation brought me all the way back to that high school race that I failed to show up for. And I just came away. I remember that flight home as though it were yesterday, just feeling this burning sense of unfinished business. And I just decided then and there, I'm finally ready to work on this. You know, on one level, I just wanted to avenge my performance and prove, you know, to whoever that I was actually not that bad an athlete. But on a much deeper level, I wanted to, you know, slay my inner coward, really. I wanted to, you know, performing better as an athlete was more about becoming a stronger, better, more fully realized human being. So I had, you know, my role model in Nataki on one side, but, you know, really that wasn't going to do the job completely just to hang around someone I looked up to. I also had to do some hard work on my own. So Nataki, this came out of left field for her because, you know, the training for endurance sports is very time consuming. And so as soon as we got back to California, I just leapt into it. And suddenly I'm spending hours a day swimming, bicycling, and running. And she's like, who is this guy? You know, this is not what I signed up for. And this is a common dynamic in a lot of relationships where one person is a runner or triathlete or whatever, and the other person is not. So it was almost like that, you know, my sport was my mistress in a sense in the relationship and, you know, the object of a lot of tension and acrimony between us.
When you did get married and things kind of got crazy, I quote her, hiking, biking, jumping, that's all you care about. I can't say it with her soulful voice, I'm sure.
Right.
But I can imagine it coming. My dad was a pastor of an all-black gospel church, and we were the only white family. Loved it every minute. But I'm telling you, boy, when they are, it doesn't matter their passion, good or bad, they are all in.
Yeah.
So I can hear her voice right now, yeah. Matt, ringing, hiking, biking, jumping.
Yeah, you get the idea. Like, yeah, and those were her exact words. It was a refrain. You know, often, you know, squabbles within a marriage, they follow familiar scripts. You know, both of you end up saying the same things over and over. And that, I heard a lot of hiking, biking, jumping from her.
At what point did you think maybe I need to change what I want to do, or did that even come close to crossing your mind?
Yeah, so, you know, to be honest, and this is a theme that comes up in the book, you know, I guess, you know, I am self-critical, but, you know, it's because I do want to hold myself to high standards. So I was still quite young when I decided that I just wasn't brave and I wanted to be brave and I needed to work on that. And endurance sports in my adulthood, running mainly, became my vehicle for that. But in the process, you know, that means by which I pursued personal growth revealed another flaw that I had sort of like glossed over for a long time, which is kind of selfishness, like a kind of self-absorption. And so that became part of the mix as well. And it was tough because I felt that I really needed to continue that journey, even though it was time consuming and it wasn't fair to Nataki. I got all that. You know, I saw it from her side, but I felt like, yeah, but I still have to do it. I have to complete this. It just felt I felt like I needed that I guess my sports as much as I needed her. And I wanted both, you know, I really wanted both. And I was just determined to just find a way, make a way. You know, and did risk losing Nataki in the process because I wasn't going to just let it go. I didn't want to lose her either. And it wasn't an easy balance.
It wasn't an easy balance. And you guys went through some crazy things, but also some other things became more evident and prominent in your marriage as a couple. And it got a little crazy at home. Nataki started experiencing things that are not typical of most people.
Yeah. Well, you know, the way it sort of, the way it unfolded was that, you know, I was selfish and self-absorbed and spending all this time, you know, doing my thing. And Nataki, you know, inevitably began to search for some other way to get what she wasn't getting from me, you know, and she got really back into church, joined, a Pentecostal church. We were in San Diego at this point. We had moved, Triathlete magazine had moved me down to San Diego. She didn't come with me immediately, but, followed, that's where we got married, was in San Diego. And so she got really into, you know, her Christian path. You know, she was raised Baptist, you know, Pentecostals, like, you know, sort of next level. And at first, you know, I thought, that's all that was going on, is that she was just really into it, you know, really into God, really into, church and the Bible and all that. But then, you know, only in retrospect did I realize she was also at about the same time developing a mental illness. I couldn't really tease them apart, you know what I mean? She just seemed like, wow, she was maybe a little too into this whole thing. You know, she would do things like, you know, fast a lot, and more than was really healthy and more than anyone else in the church seemed to do, you know what I mean? So it's something that starts off as just normal enough. It wasn't my thing, but I mean, it was plenty of other people were doing it who were, you know, of sound body and mind. But it got more and more extreme with Nataki, and only when things, you know, I'm pretty slow on the uptake sometimes. So maybe another husband would have realized what was going on more sooner than I did. But, you know, things really had to go haywire before, you know, I realized that she was sick.
Well, she had multiple incidences and near-death experiences for you. I mean, literally near-death experiences. Some might sit there just listening to your story and would question your right mind to stand beside her, because you did. You're still married to her. You make 18 years being married to her this year, but you did stand beside her. What was that draw and why?
Yeah, you know, it was a few things. One was, I realized when, you know, Nataki was hospitalized for the first time, when she had a diagnosis, I realized, you know, it wasn't really a moral decision. It was a gut decision. I realized I still love this woman and I want to be there for her. And I realized, well, I had no idea, but I had some sense of what that meant, you know, because even before the diagnosis, it hadn't been easy. You know, I'm a little uncomfortable when some people congratulate me for sticking with Nataki. Oh, you're a good man. Because that's really not what was going on. I was doing what I wanted to do. I wasn't acting out of a sense. Yes, there were my marriage vows at play, but that wasn't really the thing. You know, when I went to visit her in that hospital for the first time, it was just this searingly heartbreaking experience. I just vowed I am never going to let her suffer alone. Now, it evolved to the point where I ended up telling her, you know, if you are not compliant with, you know, the trying to become well, then that would be eventually a deal breaker for me. So, you know, it was qualified in a certain way, but basically I was all in. And in a way, you know how fate kind of can line things up for you. It became my best opportunity to be the man I wanted to be. You know, it's not something I ever would have chosen, but the stakes were so much higher than those of finishing a race or quitting. You know what I mean? This was life. and it just, nothing could possibly have mattered more. So, you know, I just wanted to be there for her, and it really for both of us. So it was almost not even a choice. It was just sort of automatic. And yeah, we went through a lot after that moment. But I never doubted it. There were times when I just wanted to check out because I just was at the breaking point. But, yeah, just abandoning her was not something I ever really considered. And people did think I was not in my right mind for hanging that, you know, even my family, I have a wonderful family, but it's understandable. You know, my brothers are like, what are you doing, man? you know, after some of the things, we went through. But I told them, I really think if you were in my shoes, you would feel differently. You just can't know, you know, unless you're in the inside of such a thing.
Well, and it's interesting, talking about being in somebody's shoes, you actually, in your book, you write about this, you ended up taking a pill of hers, and you got a taste of what it was like to be on her medication and how, quote unquote, drugged she was.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. You know, I was... And this gets back to my sort of selfishness. By no means did I handle this whole thing well. I had the desire to, but I wasn't good at being, you know, the husband and caregiver to someone with a serious mental illness. And I did all kinds of things wrong. And, you know, and I was just naive. You know, I hadn't had a lot of experience with this sort of thing. And so, you know, my whole deal initially was, just take your pills, everything will be fine. And I lacked empathy for, I just thought the disease is the problem, the pills are the solution, but it's not that simple. You know, probably 100 years from now, hopefully 100 years from now, treatments for mental illness will be a lot better. And they're a lot better today, and they were a lot better in 2004 when Nataki was diagnosed than they were 100 years before, you know, ago. But they're still not great. You know, they're kind of like sledgehammer, you know, that they do some good, but they do a lot of bad with the good, you know, a lot of side effects, you know, that, you know, the good comes at a cost. And yeah, I just accidentally ingested one of Nataki's pill one day. You know, she actually just dissolved it in water as a way to try, and cause she really didn't want to take it. So she tried different ways to sort of make it easier. And I just thought, whoa, that looks like a nice glass of water. Drank it. But then, you know, I experienced some of those side effects. And those are only the acute ones, right? I didn't take a pill a day for a month and, you know, and gain the weight that you gain, you know, and all that other stuff. But I just, yeah, it did not feel good. You know, I did not like the way my head felt. And so, yeah, that I did sort of, you know, get a chance to walk a mile in her shoes, and it had definitely increased my empathy for her situation.
Well, y'all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Life is a Marathon, a memoir of love and endurance. I love, Matt, that in your title, you write a memoir of love and endurance. Love came first. And I sit here listening to you talk about Nataki, and I can just hear your heart and how connected you are to her, that truly she is your soulmate. What was the purpose, or was there any thought that you put the word love first and then endurance?
Yeah. Sounds better, but you know, it's funny there, at the very front of the book, there are a couple of epigraphs that, you know, just quotes that I took from, I'm just looking at them right now. One is from George Sheehan, author of a book called Wisdom for the Soul. He writes, "Success rests with having the courage and endurance and above all the will to become the person you are, however peculiar that may be. Then you will be able to say, I have found my hero and he is me." So that quote is all about, there's a tension, you know, between love and endurance. Like, that's all about your interior journey, you know, becoming the person you want to be, irrespective of whoever else is around you, who you have relationships with, But the second epigraph comes from the novel The Names by Don DeLillo, and goes like this: I believe deeply in the idea of two people. It's the only sanity, the only richness. I believe both of those things. You know what I mean? Like that a life without a partner is not a life worth living. That's the way I feel. You know, that's just the way I'm wired. But also I believe very much in that sort of that inner journey, you know, that no matter what sort of life you live, you need to be strong, and it takes courage to live a good life. It's going to be hard. Your life may start easy, but it's going to get hard at some point. And you have to be strong. And you have to be someone who respects yourself and knows your strength. But so you need both of those things, or at least I do, the love and the endurance. But there is a tension between them. And that's sort of more than the order of the words in the subtitle. That's what I'm trying to capture there, is that they're both necessary, but they can be hard. They can tug on each other. And it can be hard to have them both in equal measure.
Well, I think it's beautiful, especially as a woman. For you, you kept saying that you didn't always do it right with Nataki, but I'm here to tell you, because of what you did, you're still together with Nataki. And with those trips that you took, and when you found her wandering that one day on that empty road that you had run on just before, and now seeing her stumbling and fumbling around because she was released again from the hospital, not getting what she needed because of how society is and how we have done everything, you still saw a spark in her. You would look at her in her eyes and see the old Nataki. What do you see today when you look into her eyes?
Yeah, it's, you know, I've definitely got her back. So, I mean, we struggled for 9 years, more than 9 years of pretty much hell. I mean, we had some good days, we had some good weeks, even a good month here and there, but it was almost unbearable. You know, it was very, very, very close to breaking both of us. But eventually things got better. Now, Nataki still has the disease. You know, it's a life sentence, and she has bad days, you know, bad hours and days, not bad weeks and months anymore, and the bad isn't nearly as bad. And that's in part because of treatment. You know, it can take a while. This is part of what I just didn't know, what we didn't know initially, is that it can take a while to find a recipe. It's also partly due to the work we've done together as a couple. It's not all about the pills, for sure. That's something I had to learn. And it's also about the inner work that she did. You know, I was working on my thing through running, trying to become stronger and just, you know, more mature, really. But she was doing the same thing for herself. She you know, she has a variety of tools she uses now. She talks to her mother and sister on the phone every single day. She loves them, you know, she's close to them, but that's not all that's about. It's about part of her self-care program. It just helps. And these are things that she discovered. So, you know, the Nataki of today is, you know, it's tempting to say I got the old Nataki back, but she's also a new and improved Nataki who still has the disease. But, you know, I love it. It's just so rewarding that we've been through so much together, and we're at the place we are now. It just feels like a reward. That's what it feels like. You know, the life we have together now feels, it's like something we earned and we deserve, and, you know, something to be relished. You know, life isn't perfect, but I don't expect it to be. But sort of that's, you know, to answer your question, when I look at her now, I see all of that.
Well, that's incredible. It just gives me chills, Matt, because I know there are people listening that struggle with someone maybe who has a mental disorder, or maybe they even feel like, am I mentally ill? What would you tell that person who's listening on either end of the spectrum? Where do they start for themselves as to the healing process or finding help?
Yeah, I think what I would consider the starting point, the thing you have to have clarity about is what you want, like, and really like what your values are. You know, what is, you have to have a vision for where you want to get to. It's easy to know you're not where you want to be. You know, something's wrong with someone who's close to me. Something's wrong with me. Okay, you know, you're probably right. But I mean, what's it going to look like when things are better? You know, that's what got me through my moments of almost complete hopelessness, is that they were never complete. You know, my hope was a clear vision for the place I wanted to get to. And it's like a North Star, you know, you can navigate by it. If you don't have that, then you just feel lost. You know, you can know something's wrong, but you don't even know which direction to take the first step in. And don't get me wrong, you have to choose where you put your foot every step along the way, but you know, the first thing is just to have that vision, that understanding of your values. What is a good life? You know, who do you want to be? So that's what I had all along, at least in that moment. You know, when I first visited Nataki in her first hospitalization, I had that absolute clarity of what the happy ending would look like. It took a long time to get there, but that was my lifeline, you know, all the way through the process.
It's a great lifeline to have. And we're not going to go into details because I truly want people to pick up their own copy of the book, because the way you wrote it, it's just, I know it was heartache at times. I felt it, the words jumping off the page at me. And at times I felt I was there as Nataki was over the top of your head with, at that time, was just a 6-inch knife. And there was also a horrible time where you thought about taking your own life and you took measures. But I really want people to pick up their own copy so they could understand that. Unfortunately, I believe that we kind of tend to brush this kind of stuff under the rug. And mental illness is real. And people suffer with it daily, and we don't talk about it enough. And I just want to thank you, honestly, for just being authentic with me as the reader. You really took my heart, and you added a piece of it that says, wait, I need to do more in this area. Me personally, that's what I took from it. And so yeah. I want other people to take their, you know, piece of the pie of your life, of your marathon, and go out and go forward, because this, we need to shine a light on this. We don't talk about it enough. We just like to think it's a stigma and we brush it under the carpet.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, if we get to the reason I wrote the book, that was the idea. You know, I imagined when I was in the process of writing it, I imagined people maybe reading it and say, you know, how could you air all your dirty laundry publicly like that? Or, you know, how could you do your wife like that, you know, to, you know, expose, you know, some of her worst moments. But, you know, obviously this was a decision we made together. And for us, it was actually really liberating just to not try to hide behind anything, not to try and make people think that we're good. Or to hide, to show 80% of it, but hide 20%. For me, we wanted. I'll speak for myself. In the worst moments for me, it sure would have been helpful if I had an example of someone who'd been exactly where I was and had come through. That would have helped a lot, because I was going on nothing but hope. And now, you know, being where we are now and looking back, I just think it's amazing, you know, amazing that we have come this far. And I think what a gift, you know, it can be to tell the whole story, to show it all, because, you know, we've been through a lot, you know, and I just think other people who are going through whatever they're going through can read this and say, wow, if they can come out the other side, you know, why can't I? That's the idea. And in order for that to work, I just felt like we had to be completely real and hold nothing back. It was either the whole story or don't bother.
Well, thank you for going all in. And yes, I do want to get to one of the reasons why, the main reasons why you wrote this book. And you went on this Life is a Marathon project. You wanted to do 8 weeks, 8 marathons. I think you're crazy, but you did it. And I just thought, okay, really? And then and that's what surprised me, as you intertwined then your personal life. But it was fascinating how it all truly worked together. What was one thing that stood out to you as you talked to people, as you went to each of your 8 marathons?
What stuck out is just how, you know, obviously the experience I have is very particular. No one else has experienced exactly what I did, but so many runners have stories that aren't that different, you know, where they were able to use this way of challenging themselves to bootstrap their way to gaining the strength that they needed to overcome whatever it was that they were dealing with. So, I mean, some people, if it's, you know, childhood abuse that they need to overcome. Some people, it's just like extreme insecurity. You know, they grew up without the message that they had value, you know, that they had something to offer, which can be crippling. It's not diagnosable, but it can really ruin your life if you don't find a way past it. You know, substance abuse. You know, I mentioned a Holocaust survivor who used running to reclaim her life. It's just, it comes in so many different flavors, but there's something universal about, you know, running, that it's sort of safe. You know, you can quit at any time, but if you challenge yourself, and it really, the challenge is more mental than physical, it becomes this tool, where you can just sort of bit by bit gain strength, become stronger, and then you don't leave it on the race course. You know, the things that you learn about yourself, the ways that you change, you get to take those with you back into everyday life and use them to live a better life, a richer life. And everywhere I went throughout this cross-country journey, I got to hear the stories of other people. Obviously, I share them in the book of people. But I think a non-runner would think, what are you talking about? It's just exercise, you know, but it really is. If you take it the whole way, it can become so much more than that. Now, I tell people all the time, if it were proven that running caused cancer, I wouldn't quit, because that's not why I do it. You know what I mean? It so happens that it does help me control my weight and relieve stress and probably reduces the risk of cancer. And I'm glad for all that, but it's really not why I do it. Like, I do it to be a better person and to live a better life. And that's really true for a lot of the people I met on my journey as well.
Well, how did this idea of Life as a Marathon project even come about?
Well, you know, I took a cross-country journey with my brothers. That's how I moved west in 1995. We took a month. I have two brothers, I'm the middle. They're really my best friends, my best male friends anyway. And it was just this incredible experience. And I met Nataki about 2 years after that. I used to tell her about it all the time. And Nataki's kind of, she has an adventurous spirit. She loves to travel. And so she just thought that was great. You know, she wanted to do it too. And she wanted to do it with me. And I wanted to do it with her, but you know, life got in the way when things went sideways for us, it just wasn't, in the cards. And it just, you know, because running is such a huge part of my life, the only way it was going to happen is if running could be a part of it somehow. But then, you know, it happened in 2017, and that's when we were finally ready. And that's when our story sort of had a happy ending. And when I looked back at at least my version of our story, it really was about love and endurance. I mean, it seems like, okay, it's a book about a marriage and running, what? But to me, you know, for me, the way I experience it, and I hope this comes through in the book, they really are kind of inseparable. So that's what, you know, this journey is really both things. It's sort of a celebration of, you know, the place we had come to in our relationship. You know, it's a journey we undertake together with our pseudo child, Queenie, the Bichon Frise. But also, you know, it was very, very running. It was a celebration of running as well. And, you know, for me, you know, Nataki had her own formula to, you know, to grow and gain strength. But for me, you know, running was a huge part of what had allowed me to contribute to our getting to that point.
Well, it definitely comes across in the book, Matt. I mean, marriage does take endurance, and running takes a love of it and also more endurance. So it does crisscross in the past. And that's what I think is so beautiful. And your words, I mean, I know you've written over 20 books, so I think you got your words down pretty good. But your detail, you truly just wrap us in the book. And that's what I loved about it. I mean, I kept walking and reading because that's what I do when I read books. And I was like, oh my gosh, I got to keep going because I got to see what happens next. Where is this going to lead us? Because honestly, I didn't know where it was going to end up. You know, I didn't know, would this be a happy ending? Would there be a reconciliation, not only with your marriage, but also with you as the person you wanted to be?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's, it's interesting because I started writing some of the material that's in the book. I actually mentioned this in the author's note. I wrote it as it happened. So you take our first date in 1997. I wrote about that not long afterward. The beautiful moment when Nataki meets my dying grandmother, you know, just one of the most powerful scenes in the book. I wrote about that as soon as we got home from that trip. This is 1998. Something, you know, I tell Nataki all the time that she's my muse. But, you know, when you are a writer, when writing is in your blood, when you have powerful experiences, you want to express them, you know, through the pen or the keyboard. So, you know, since, and as I mentioned in the book, I've also written a lot of songs for Nataki. She's a singer. So, you know, something about her just inspires me to write about her, to write about us, to write for her. But in order to share our story, like, you know, a version of this book that I would have written, say, in 2008, wouldn't have ended up the way this book did. It would have been kind of tragic, you know. So it was necessary to wait until the story was complete, in a sense. Of course, you know, we're still in our 40s. Hopefully, we'll have another story to tell, but that story achieved a kind of completion. And when it did, I knew it. And Nataki knew it. And we both felt, okay, it's time.
Well, I'm so glad personally that you did. And I've read a lot of books in my lifetime, and I probably read more now than I ever did. I don't tell my kids this, but, you know, I was not a reader, but now I read sometimes 2-3 books a week. And it's just something about it. And yours, oh my goodness, yeah, it's going to go on my must-read list for all of my children. I want them to see it. I want them to really digest it. There are so many learning, you know, wrapped up within your book. And it's not just about running. Some people would say, oh my goodness, what is this? Is it a self-help book? No, it's a book about life. Life is a marathon. And with that, I'm sure you've learned some incredible things along the way through your 8 marathons, the Life is a Marathon project. What is one thing that stunned you personally that you learned?
Boy, are you talking about on that journey or?
Either.
Yeah. I guess, you know, one thing that, because there's some things I've always known, like following your passion is something I've always known. My parents taught me that early. I've always done it. And so nothing in my life since those early days has changed my mind about, you know, the value of sort of going where your heart leads you. But one thing I've only come to appreciate more recently, and that really was clarified for me by that the trip we took, is just how much control you really have about what goes on inside your head. Now, that might sound funny coming from someone, you know, who's been affected so closely by mental illness where you lose control. I'm not suggesting that we have absolute control, you know, not even close, but we don't really have control of anything else. You know, that's the thing we can choose our thoughts and we can choose who we want to be and take steps in that direction. But it's hard. It's not easy. It's almost like you have to have an umpire in your head who's sort of watching you all the time. But that umpire is you. And so to gain that sort of perspective on yourself is not easy. Doesn't always really come naturally. It's something you have to sort of be intentional about. During the trip, I finally felt like I was getting some momentum there where I didn't just react like if Nataki had a bad day or a bad hour, or if, you know, there were all kinds of, you know, you can imagine driving 10,000 miles and running eight marathons, things are going to go wrong, you know, all kinds of stuff. And I found in this process that I had a greater ability, you know, a hard earned ability to not just react, you know what I mean? And just have these reflexive responses, which are generally unskillful. You know what I mean? They're not, when you just react, you usually don't make the best move, but also emotionally you experience it as a lack of control, which is unpleasant. And what I found is that I still have a long way to go, but when I experienced stress or setbacks on this journey, I had gotten to a point where I felt like I could choose my reaction. And usually when you do choose, and when I did, it was a better one. I made the right move instead of the wrong move. And also it wasn't as miserable as an experience. Like the stress was there, but it wasn't that sense of being out of control. And, you know, oh my God, you know, what next? So that, you know, that I think is something I hope people take away from the book, is that you have more control over the contents of your head than you think you do. And it's really liberating when you get to the point where you feel like you do have some control. You know what I mean? You just felt like you're not at the mercy of other people, of, you know, things, you know, oh, things don't always have to go your way. You're not as anxious. If it rains, it's ruined. You know, well, so be it. Move your picnic inside.
Exactly. Move that picnic inside. Well, it's interesting that you say that we control our thoughts. We do. We have that control. And it was when I was reading that, I did get that. And also when you were running the races, I was like, you had to make some choices, like which direction to go. Like, where was the arrow pointing? Were we supposed to go right or were we supposed to turn around? Was this a roundabout or was this, you know, front to back? And I was like, whoa, whoa. I was learning lots of terminology there of races, right? Because I walk marathons and I may run equal to marathons in a week, but I do not actually run the marathon. So I was just amazed by really your insight into what it taught you personally. Queenie, I know, is just all about the licks and she's really good at timing. What do you think, or has Nataki shared with you what she has seen the change within you going through this Life as a Marathon project?
Yeah, you know, it's something, one of the things I love about Nataki is that, like I said, she's real, which means she doesn't sugarcoat, you know, her opinions about me, or, what she'll call me out. If for whatever, you know what I mean? It doesn't really matter what it is, but also she'll give me credit, for whatever I might deserve credit for. So what's great is, you know where you stand with her. And when she does credit me for something, I know she's not just saying it, that, you know, that it's real, that what she is seeing has some substance. And, I did get to the point, in the years leading up to this journey and during this journey, where Nataki would say, you know, you've changed. And that feels good because, you know, there's a lot of inertia with me. Like Nataki is the sort of person who she'll sort of, you know, she doesn't literally do this, but she sort of makes a mental list, like, here's the five things I don't want to do. And then those are the first five things she does. You know what I mean? She's always actively working on herself, which my brother often says, everyone wants to feel better. Not that many people want to be better. Nataki is all about being better. And, you know, as we've discussed, I am to a certain degree too. That's why discovering I was a coward didn't sit well with me. But I am not nearly as active in Nataki in that self-work. So it's a slower process for me. So, you know, to feel like I am getting credit from her now, because she's a fair umpire, it means, I've actually have taken some steps forward, which is nice.
Oh, that's awesome. Well, what does the future hold for you in running?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. When I was young, I used to wonder, because I was very competitive. You know, I quit when I was 17, got back into it in a serious way when I was, 27-ish, 28. And I used to wonder, around that time, late 20s, early 30s, what's going to keep me in this when I get older and slow down? Because all I thought I cared about was getting faster, improving, doing more. And then, I did get older and I did start slowing down, and I realized how naive I was about, how naive the 28-year-old me was, because there's so much more in it. It really is, running for me is just this journey that always takes me somewhere new. And again, a non-runner might think it's just running. It's the same thing every time, but it's not, because, you're always changing. And, I actively try different things. Two summers ago, I spent the whole summer in Flagstaff training with a team of professional runners with twice my talent and who are half my age. And it was just this amazing experience. You know what I mean? I mentioned the book. I did a marathon in Kenya. It was basically a safari without the Jeep. I just keep trying different things. Right now I'm training for an Ironman triathlon, my first one in 17 or 18 years. I'm going to try and beat the 31-year-old me. That's just it. I don't know what it's going to be like when I hope I'm still running, when I'm 57, 67. I don't know. I hope so. And I anticipate that when I do, I'll just be experiencing it in a different way than I am now.
Wow. Well, when is that Ironman triathlon?
May 11th.
May 11th. Okay.
Who's counting?
Who's counting? Yeah, that's just around the corner. You do realize that.
Yeah. I've been training. I'm glad it's not today, but I'm working hard.
Well, for the person who's sitting here going, you know what? Maybe running would do me some good. Where is their starting line? Where is their first step?
This is probably not the conventional advice, but it is my heartfelt and honest advice. I believe that you need to fall in love with it. There's so many people that they'll start running because they have no expectation of loving it, let alone, or liking it, let alone loving it. It's like, oh, it'll be a good way to lose weight, or it'll help me, avoid a heart attack or something. It's just sort of utilitarian, pragmatic things they want to get out of it. They want to be healthier, feel younger. And all those things are valuable. They're things you should want. But the people who end up sticking with it and actually enjoying those benefits are the ones who fall in love with it. If you don't, you're just not going to be doing it, because it is hard. You're not going to be doing it. What matters is not whether you're doing it a week from now, it's whether you're still doing it a year from now, 2 years from now. That's how, it's not like an inoculation. You run once and you're good to go for the rest of your life. You got to keep doing it. And the only people who keep doing it love it. And, you can fall in love with it. If you hate it today, that does not mean you're going to always hate it. It's like coffee is for a lot of people, an acquired taste. But what I find is often the trigger that gets people to fall in love with it is crossing that first finish line. There's just, I call it the finish line magic. There's just something about it. So a lot of people, they'll set a goal to lose like 10 pounds or whatever, which is fine. But those goals really don't hook people the way saying, you know, I'm going to do that 5K fun run in my town 6 weeks from now. I'm sure not ready today. And it scares me a little bit. And if I fail, I'll fail in public because a lot of my neighbors and friends will be out there and they'll, you know what I mean? But that's part of it that should scare you a little bit, because that's how you start on that journey where you're testing yourself. You're putting yourself out there where you could possibly fail. And even if you do, that's actually all to the good. You know, if you decide I got knocked down, but you know what, I'm going to get back up. That's all part of it. Yeah. But I've seen it so many times when people cross that first finish line, even if it is only a 5K, if you have to, you know, walk parts of it, whatever, it just leaves, you know, some people say, okay, that's enough, but so many people say, you know what, I think I could do better next time. You know, I think I might be able to do a 10K next time or whatever. And then that process has begun.
Well, I know people are going to want to connect with you because you are a coach and they're going to probably want to pick up your book. I know I picked up a copy and read it all. Life is a Marathon, a Memoir of Love and Endurance. I'm telling you, you will be totally, oh gosh, I don't even have the words to say. I mean, captivated isn't even a big enough word. It's truly life-changing. And life is a marathon. You're on a journey, sir. And I know people are going to want to connect with you on your journey, maybe even cheering you on at your Ironman. Where can they connect with you?
Yeah, the best place to start would be my personal website, which is mattfitzgerald.org, not .com. That's some other Matt Fitzgerald. Mine is mattfitzgerald.org.
Okay, well, we will be sure to have that information in the show notes. Well, before I let you go, Matt, it has truly been an honor to have you here. I have one last question for you. The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
Strength. I mean, I'm not saying that because I think you want to hear it. I mean, that's, if you read the book, that's what you'll see. And I don't know if it's, I hope it doesn't sound like a macho thing, because it's really not. I just, as I said before, I feel like you have to be a strong person to live a good life. You need to love and be loved and all that other stuff too. But you got to be strong. You got to find strength somewhere. And you're probably not born with all the strength you're going to need to live the best possible life. So that's what my story really is in large measure. A story of finding the strength to live the life I want to live and to be the person I want to be.
Well, you have definitely found that, and I so appreciate you sharing that story and your strength with us. I pray that it blesses many of those who will read it.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed talking to you.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.